Wait. You have a TV?
No. I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide. You don't need a TV.
Hello and happy Wednesday to you. It is Ken Reed of TV Guidance Counselor fame. Of TV Guidance Counselor. Let's just say that. I think that's more accurate. And appropriately, this is TV Guidance Counselor, and I am your host. This is the show where I talk about old television, classic television, usually focusing on the 60s, 70s, and 80s, and sometimes 90s. I sound like a radio DJ. The big hits of the 60s, 70s, 80s, and today. Incredible people, very interesting people, friends, old friends, new friends, people who've made television, people who've been on the television we watch, and just people with a great life story and interesting viewpoints on television and how it fits into our lot. Today is no exception. My guest is the writer, actress, Angela Featherstone. Loved talking to Angela. She's a fascinating person, very smart, super fun, really great time talking to her. You may recognize her from movies like The Wedding Singer. She played Linda, who stood up Adam Sandler's character at the wedding, or she was a regular on Friends and was in the movie Dark Angel the Ascent, which probably most of my listeners have seen, which is not a joke. That is 100% true. If there was one thing she was in that I would guess that the people who listen to this show had seen, it would probably be a movie produced by Full Moon Pictures, as we discuss in this episode. Among many, many other things, as I said, she is a fascinating person, and I really, really enjoyed talking to her. I was out in LA recently and talked to a ton of people, and she was definitely a highlight of that trip, which is saying a lot, because I talked to some great people. But Angela's great. You will listen to this episode. You will like this episode. I don't know why I'm like sort of hypnotizing you with weird, blunt suggestions here, but I'm sure you will enjoy this episode, even if you like it half as much as I enjoyed recording the episode. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy today's episode of TV Guidance Counselor with my guest, Angela Featherstone.
TV is my friend, and it has been always there for me in time of need.
Miss Angela Featherstone, how are you?
I'm really good, thank you.
You're welcome. And she shuts the door. Very professional for sound. We have the
leaf blower. I just heard a little wind blower.
Yes. I was like,
or
I know
leaf blower, I guess.
She is the entertainment professional, very subtly shutting the door. Thank you so much for doing this. I have enjoyed a ton of things that you've done over the years, which is why I thought of you to speak to you about stuff. And you have a really varied, interesting sort of catalog of things that you've done over the years. And you grew up in Canada?
I did.
Toronto? Is that where?
No. Okay. Technically I was born in Hamilton. I spent a couple weeks there, but my parents are both five generations from Nova Scotia.
Okay.
Although I'm not sure that that's actually true anymore, but they're both from Nova Scotia. And then later when I was 9 or 10, we moved to Manitoba. So I lived all over Manitoba. And then when I was 16 and a half, I went to Toronto.
So Manitoba's like pretty rural.
Yes. Yeah, okay. Yes, all right. Very much so. As is Nova Scotia.
One of the Kids in the Hall lives there.
Oh, really?
Which brings to, I think one of the first things you did was, I think you were an extra in a Kids in the Hall episode.
Well, actually, it wasn't one of the first things I did, but it was one of the things I did.
Okay.
The first thing I did actually was I was in a Guy Madden movie. His very first movie, and it was my first movie. I wasn't really intending on. There was a part of me that was interested, always had a sense that I was an actress since I was really young, inexplicably.
I think it's just a thing you know.
Like, I think it's a DNA thing you know. It's a, yeah. And then it was affirmed for me when I was reading a book about Marlon Brando, and we had the same birthday, and we'd both had tough childhoods, and it was almost like, I was like, oh, yes,
yeah.
Yes, that, yes.
Perfect. This is exactly
right. I needed
to
see it in writing, and now I remember. And so I was drawn to this opportunity with Guy Madden, but it wasn't like a big thing for me. It was more like, oh, show up there and do this. Then the next thing I did was I became a model, and I was traveling all over the world. And then I happened to be in Paris, and I met Roman Polanski, and through him, his girlfriend, then Emmanuel Seigneur, and they were making a movie at that time, or were about to begin making a movie called Frantic. And I ended up being an extra in that, but it was really like I was friends with them. I was hanging out with them.
Which is a pretty good education on a movie set.
Well, that was interesting. And for me, that what was, I didn't really learn that much per se because I wasn't in a place of studying. It was more like, those are my friends.
Right.
Where do you want me to sit? Where are we going to go after? What happened, though, that was super interesting was because I was in that movie with him and I was hanging out with them, I became much more aware of him.
Right.
And there happened to be a Polanski film retrospective. Right.
So you had not really seen a lot of his stuff before.
I don't think I'd ever seen any of his movies at that point. I had seen, I was already a pretty well versed film buff. I had years before that, like when I was like 18 and 19, I would go to Tokyo to model. And I would, they are real film aficionados there. And
absolutely.
So I would, they would actually have at my video store, they actually had every great filmmaker, like kind of like they
sections?
Do at Vidiots.
Yeah.
And they had a film section. So it was like Hitchcock, and then it was every single Hitchcock
right.
in alphabetical order. And then a Truffaut and every single
Truffaut.
It's
like, here's the reading
film.
For the quarter. Yeah. It's all here. Yeah.
And that's what I would do is I would literally take out as many movies as you can
right.
from each filmmaker at a time. And I would go through, I went through every Hitchcock. And then I went through every Truffaut. And then I went through every Ozu. And I went through, every, you know, just sort of making my way. And but for some reason, I think because Polanski to me seemed scary.
He had like a horror reputation.
And I kind of, that's not really my thing. I was interested in like Tess. I was interested in Nastasia Kinski because like Cat People had been one of the first movies that I'd seen.
Yes.
So I sort of came to him, I think, through Nastasia Kinski. But anyhow, I digress. The thing is that I there was at this incredible cinema right next to the Notre Dame Cathedral. Every single day and night of a Polanski film.
So imagine showing like Repulsion because Catherine Deneuve and The
Tenant.
I
saw every movie
stuff,
and he would come and speak and introduce almost every movie. So I'd work with him at night and then in the day I'd go to see the movies and on my own and I'd listen to him talk. So it was, that's where I got the education. I'm working with him as an acquaintance and at nighttime and I'm experiencing being on a set and being noticed in that way
right.
as a director and a artist of my whatever ilk that is. And then going and studying and watching the movies
right.
and listening to people speak and getting that.
So you're seeing the kind of
side.
Practical part and then how it reads from the other side as like 100%. A viewer, but like immediately.
Yeah.
It's like 4 years of film school in a week,
yeah.
like cram session. That's pretty amazing.
Yeah. And I think that that's probably where I began to access tone because you get a human tone.
Mm-hmm.
You get the tone of the person and how they act as an artist, an
right.
auteur. And then you see them being an intellectual and observing their own work. And then also you get to feel how they feel as a person meets how they feel and how you feel when you watch one of their movies, what they're trying
right.
to say.
How their life experience translates to their art.
Exactly.
Which is odd with visual media like film and television because it's not – even with auteurs, you have to funnel it through an army of people. So it's sort of a weird, it's not like a painting where it's literally just you and the canvas and paint. You have to sort of also navigate other people's personalities, experiences, and whatever. So whenever someone manages to make something that's very much them, it really amazes me because they've managed to get it through all of these gates, which is kind of fascinating.
Yeah.
I also love how he was able to do like comedic stuff, like Fearless Vampire Killers and that kind of stuff.
Oh, that's the movie with Sharon Tate, right?
Yes. But managed to capture the feel of like all those Hammer horror movies, but also is like funny and weird and creepy and sort of a weird anomaly in his movies.
Yeah.
So you acted in that and then did you move back to Toronto and say, I want to be an actor, I'm going to do acting?
No, I modeled for a while. That was just sort of a part of the modeling story, but it was my second acting gig. And then I continued to study movies, watch them. When I was in Italy, I watched all the Italian films and
Fellini.
And read books. My life was just sort of like, it was like, it would be different. In Italy, I went to Cinecittà.
Right.
I shot a commercial there. I became obsessed with the La Scala. So I was interested in opera. And then I was, for some reason, when I was in Italy, I was obsessed with the Beatles and also Hermann Hesse. Like, so it, okay. didn't it wasn't necessarily geographical, but it was whatever was the impression of that place. Beatles was big in Italy at that moment, and Hermann Hesse was big at that moment. And obviously, I'm there. I'm shooting at a commercial at Cinecittà with Ugo Tognazzi. I'm going to become interested in who all the Italian filmmakers are and which ones I like.
Did you have favorites that stood out for you? Or
Bertolucci's The Conformist is probably one of my favorite movies of all time. And also Zeffirelli. I became very interested in Zeffirelli's beginnings as a set designer.
Right.
As an artist.
Which makes perfect
sense
when you see his stuff and then, Romeo and Juliet.
Yeah.
Or
later, as my interest in opera continued, he does the sets for the New York Opera.
Oh, I didn't even know that.
Yeah. And they're incredible. And I read his biography. I'm very interested in him. And I do love his Romeo and Juliet.
That was the first version of that I saw. And I think I saw it, I don't know, I was a kid. But it was one of those things where I was like, this is going to be boring. But I was like, oh, this is actually very engaging and really just, it is like a painting. Like, you kind of get absorbed just by looking at it, even if you have the sound off. It's fun to watch. Did you speak any other languages, or were you kind of just like, I'm going to absorb everything the best that I can, however
I
can?
Well, I learned, growing up in rural Manitoba, the only radio station we had was a German radio station.
Oh, really?
So my brain was pushed past its normal limit. German is... For me, you can listen to German and hear English a lot.
It's a very Germanic language.
Way more than Latin. And so is it a very Germanic language?
Yeah, English is considered Germanic.
So my childlike brain was easily able to adapt to that. I was able to pick up languages pretty quickly. And I learned Japanese, and I love Japanese.
That is a hard language.
When I went there a lot. And there... It's a hard thing. I just learned a word a day. If you do that, the Japanese are the type of people who are very... They don't expect anything from you. They don't want you to learn Japanese. Nobody gives a hoot what you do.
Right.
But if you do like it, and you are interested in
they're
it,
like,
and
let's
you're
help.
If you are like, if you have what they call ikanji, like you have sort of like, you know, a sensibility that's not dissimilar to theirs.
Right. They feel like you're trying to
then they welcome you and they meet you more than halfway and they'll bring you into their home and it just makes it a lot easier. They'll let you practice. Basically, they do that incredibly generous gesture of allowing you to speak shitty language.
Which France would not do, where they're like, no, don't even stop. I'm just going to talk to you in English because you're offending me with your attempt.
Yeah. And also I grew up speaking... you know, Canadian French. And so there's that whole stigma and they're really mean to you. And then Italian I loved as well. The sort of the languages that have lots of O's in them, I like. I don't like the ch.
Yeah, they don't like the harsh sort of guttural languages.
I don't speak French and I don't speak German. I understand a lot of German, but I don't speak it.
Because Japanese, unlike, say, like some of the other Asian languages, like I tried to learn Cantonese for a while, they are sort of more guttural than Japanese, which sounds sort of harsh to people, but is actually a pretty more of almost like a romance-sounding language in movies and things.
Yes, I agree with you.
Yeah.
I agree with you.
I could only count to 10. That was as far as I got, I think, in what I remember in Japanese.
I remember, it's true, there is a sort of, when I watch films from China, or even sometimes, I don't know, like whatever, I don't know what they're from, but even when you're just like in some place, I don't know where you go, but I've been places where for some reason Asian movies, non-Japanese, are in the background playing, and there is something captivating about it.
Yeah. I mean, when I was growing up in Boston, we had in our Chinatown, we had a Shaw Brothers theater, who were the Chinese, like Warner Brothers.
Oh, really?
And there was only 3 Shaw Brothers theaters outside of Hong Kong. And one, for some random reason, was in Boston.
Wow.
And it's now a parking garage and a restaurant. But I would go there and just watch movies.
Nice.
And I would see like John Woo movies and
I love 70s,
you know, big historical epics. No clue. They're all in Mandarin or Cantonese. No clue what they're saying.
Mm.
But I kind of would get what was going on. And that's where I first saw Hard Boiled and The Killer. And
remember Hard Boiled?
I love that movie.
I'm very grateful to Quentin Tarantino, because if not for him, I don't know that I would have ever discovered John Woo.
Yeah, I think that's true of a lot of people. When we had that weird sort of not a British invasion, but like a Chinese invasion in the 90s, where we started getting like John Woo and Yuen Biu and Corey Yoon, who was all of a sudden everyone knew Kung Fu in every movie. But that was a good thing. And part of that, yeah, was Quentin Tarantino, because City on Fire was such a huge influence on like Reservoir Dogs and all those kind of movies. But oh, that opening scene in Hard Boiled and the tea shop with no dialogue and he's sliding down the bit.
Yes, that's
incredible. Incredible.
That. Yeah.
So when you were growing up, aside from the radio, did you watch a lot of TV or was there? No,
we
nothing.
Were not allowed to have TV.
You weren't allowed to even have one. No. So when was the first time you saw anything on television when you moved to Toronto?
When I would babysit, I would watch Dallas.
Okay.
When I was like 15.
So it was like a forbidden fruit kind of thing? Like, I'm getting away with something?
Are you kidding me?
Yeah.
It was forbidden fruit. I remember being allowed to watch. There was a lifelong debate about the TV. My stepfather wanted one. And he would get one, and then my mother would throw it out on the front lawn. And then, you know, a month and a half later, he would come back with one, and then it would be given away, like, to somebody from the church who was less, you know, it was like an ongoing thing. But I have memories of being able to watch Black Beauty when I was a kid.
A very
so there
Canadian
is
show.
That.
Imagine your stepdad was like, I need to watch Hockey Night in Canada. It's the I can't be a Canadian citizen without watching Hockey Night in Canada.
I don't even think he was like that. I think I remember he liked watching golf. But other than that, I don't really know why I think they just liked to fight. It was like a given argument.
Yeah.
If you fight about TV. So I watched Dallas when I was babysitting, and then that was it. And I never went to the movies. The first movie I ever saw when I was 17, I went to 3 movies in a row. I saw Cat People, The Wall, and The Story of O all in a month.
That is an education and a half right there.
My first movies. Yeah.
Cat People is one of the weirder movies to see as your first. Because you would be like, oh, all movies are like this. Malcolm McDowell turns into a panther.
Well, see, that's the thing, is it's not weird if you don't have anything
exactly.
to relate it to.
Yeah.
You just think that's, you're like, oh, this thing. Oh,
yeah,
my God.
That's your standard now.
This is incredible. These people are crazy, just like me.
And David Bowie probably does music for every movie.
Yeah, well, I didn't. You know how it is. You don't think there's any. Well, I don't even think, this isn't strange because it's the opposite of strange.
Yeah, you have no comparison.
You just go, this is a movie.
Yeah, this is what. I've heard of movies, and this is what everyone was talking about.
This is what everyone's talking about. Yeah. And it wasn't until, like, years. I mean, but I always have. I mean, if you really watch great filmmakers, they're not. There's consistency there.
Yeah.
There's not a boring great movie. The Seventh Seal is
no
more weird than Cat People.
That's
or
true.
No less weird. It's all in an Atonement. I love the movie Atonement. It's to me, they all the movies that I love all have elements of those movies.
Yeah,
really?
I mean, I think that sort of genre and like the auteur people or the people that, you know, like Tarantino or David Lynch or David Cronenberg are the people that people tend to really gravitate towards and be very, very loyal to their filmography tend to be the people who do sort of have a little stranger, quirkier outlook. And that tends to be more memorable and also tends to be more of them in the movie rather than like a workman kind of action movie director, you know, there are big blockbuster movies that people, I couldn't even tell you who directed them or who wrote
them. And all 3 of those movies have, I feel, are courageous.
Well, they're strong female characters and main characters, basically.
Not in The Wall.
Although
Geldof is arguably
kind of a little feminine in that movie. That's
but,
true.
But like you see, because I'm just thinking, like, I really liked that movie Secretary.
Maggie Gyllenhaal.
Yeah. And that's not unlike The Story of O. And I don't know, you can look at Cat People and see traces of A Place in the Sun.
True.
There's just to me, you know, like, I don't know.
See the DNA in when you watch a movie.
I don't think it's, and I guess what I'm trying to say is it's not like I watched, I can't even think of a reference of like a really boring plane film that's fantastic. I mean, Tender Mercies isn't horribly twisted. I don't know. But I guess my point is that I think I would argue that all the movies that I love have aspects of those films. And not because those films Not because my brain was created by watching those films, but rather I think that there's threads of genius in those movies. And the consistency with all other great movies is that there's also threads of genius.
Right.
And that's, I think, what I respond to.
Yeah, it's I would always kind of put it as like a sincerity in that even if they didn't accomplish what they were trying to set out to do, they had a sincere effort to do something interesting. And sometimes it didn't quite get to the where it could have gotten. But I'd rather watch that than like a well-executed boring thing.
I do, I would argue as well, not that we're awfully argumentative.
She's hit me every time she said that, everybody. It hasn't come across.
But you could say too that at a certain point, the message that the auteur is trying to get across is becomes longer lasting than where the person ends in the car at the end of the scene. Yes.
Does it stick with you when you walk out of that movie?
Exactly. I remember seeing back to Polanski, Bitter Moon, and I was fucking devastated.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, I was picking a fight with everybody that was walking out of the theater.
That's a gut punch movie.
And like literally, I went with a group of friends and I was like, I gotta go.
I need some time for me after this. Yeah.
And that's the sense of, that I get from most, you know, you have to process. And I don't remember, I can't tell you. I mean, I remember some scene in an apartment, in a kitchen, in a bedroom, and I know Emmanuel Sinner was in it. I can't tell you what actually happened in the movie, but I can tell you what the theme was of the movie and that it just devastated me.
Yeah, I think it's Picasso who said this, and I always quote this line, and I always look it up and forget who said it, but that art is a lie that tells the truth. So it's kind of like the details aren't as important as the vibe, as the feel, is what you take away with it. And I think some of that's missed now. There's a place for just distracting, kind of fun,
except for
stuff.
Season 4 of Ray Donovan.
Yes, which you happen to be in.
Which I happen to be in, but that's not why. I mean, it's really, I think that's exactly, that is David Hollander. Does that, and he does it well.
Where and that show also is builds a really great history to it. Mm-hmm. The thing about that show, and I think a lot of we're in this kind of golden age of television thing that people are doing now, is everything's not an origin story anymore, which is what movies don't do when they're good. The people on screen had a life before the events of the movie and after the events of the movie, or feel like they did. Where you're like, yeah, this is a real character that did things. They didn't just kind of show up as soon as the movie started and then disappear when it was over, which I think we've all seen movies that feel that way too.
It's really interesting.
And that movie seems like it as well, because you have that multi-generational, like with John Voight's character, and also obviously the Boston connection.
Right.
Yeah. Where it's like, oh, I know those guys. I think my uncle used to hang out with this gentleman. Then the first movie I remember seeing you in where you had a big role was probably Dark Angel, I think.
Then I went back, I finished modeling, and then I went back to Canada, and I got my GED, and I went to college for a year. And then my friend got sick, and so I went to Toronto, and I was being with him for a year. I was 25, and my friend was dying, and I was just kind of like, farting around in Toronto, and I was working for a friend to make money and support myself, and then I was friends with the showrunner at Kids in the Hall, and he gave me a background story.
Is that Norm?
Well, Lauren Michaels is the executive producer. And Joe Forrestal was the showrunner. I just was like a extra in the chicken lady scene for
the
for
male stripper. Had you watched that show before then?
No.
Because it's always hard for me to gauge how big that show was in Canada.
Oh, I think it was massive, but I'd been away.
Right.
So I missed the whole story. And also, I didn't care.
Because you weren't used to having TV or, why would you?
I was like, oh, that's nice. Yeah. Everybody has a show. Yeah. I don't care.
It's Canada.
I'm just trying to get my fucking GED. You know, I liked being there. I remember that I thought the chicken lady was fun. And my friend who was actually dying had dated Scott Thompson. And so they had been like big loves. They had this huge, big romance.
Right.
And so for me, watching Scott was exciting and it was neat for me. It was like a heart moment.
Right.
And my friend who was the showrunner was dear to me. And so it was like a nice little moment. And then, and it's funny because I never saw it. I mean, why would I watch me being in a background person? But
well, a lot of people would, because they'd be like, that's me. I'm right there. Well, but it sounds like you kind of
I'd already been on the cover of a book. Yeah, it's not a big deal. I was okay. And I never really was a big pay attention to all that stuff kind of a person. I'm sort of like surviving most of the time. Right. Like, I'm just like, what's next?
Well, it sounds like even that Kids in the Hall is very similar to your experience in the Polanski movie. It was like, here are people that are friends and I know them.
Exactly.
And this is just their place of work. And I'm kind of got involved in a, you know, roundabout way. And that's it.
Yeah. And all sort of connected to and leading to something that I sense was where I might be supposed to be going. It's not like I was spending a day working at a shoe store.
Dreaming of Hollywood or
anything. Yeah, it was like there was elements of it while I was seemingly nonplussed. There was also an element of like, this feels good. I like this. So then I go to New York and all right, so now my friend's dying wish is that I go and be an actress. And so I get a ticket to New York and I go back to New York where I'd lived off and on for years. I get there and I get an agent right away named Lenore Zerman, a wonderful woman who's a very successful manager and an executive producer now. She runs Don Cheadle's company with him. And they made that wonderful movie about Miles Davis that I loved. Mm-hmm. I thought he was incredible and impressed at what a great job he did directing. Sometimes not all actors can be good directors. And so anyhow, I came out to LA. She sent me out to LA. I did a quick spot. My first acting gig that got me into the union was a couple of days on Army of Darkness.
Yep, you're in the S-Mart reshoots, I think.
I was in the S-Mart reshoots, and that was fun. And then not long after that, the same casting director brought me in for Dark Angel. And I got the lead in Dark Angel and went to Romania for a couple of months to shoot there.
Charles Band's Full Moon Pictures had bought a castle in Romania and had basically built a studio there, I think, in post-revolutionary
Romania. Not when I was there.
Maybe it was the first movie he did then in Romania.
Maybe. I'm not... Maybe. It was really close to Ceaușescu had barely been dead at, like, over a year. And people, it was like, I don't think there had been very many movies made there before me, if any.
No.
But that was interesting, too, because I got to read a lot of, I got to find out about Hungarian and Romanian authors and poets that I'd never heard of before. And our DP was this guy named Vivi Dragon, who was actually he was probably in his 70s at that time. And he was a really old school DP. He had made tons of movies.
Yeah.
And in very heavy-handed and very talented. So here I was making this
horror movie.
Yeah. Although, to be kind.
It's probably the best movie Full Moon made, I will say.
Many people have said that.
Yeah.
Many people have said that. And it's in no small part to Vivi Dragon, because he made it look like an exquisite film. Yeah. This is a very talented DP.
There's a lot of visual references to some amazing, like, silent films and, like, the depictions of hell.
Well, Hassani, too, because Linda did a lot of... Linda's a very smart woman, and she studied a lot and really brought a lot of... The goal was, basically, from what I could tell from her and from Vivi, was to make... Within this context of it being like a $40 budget,
right,
and in Romania right after Ceaușescu was dead, with no food and starvation and young
abandoned
and parents,
buildings,
parents and... bringing their teenage girls to any American that would take them in the hopes that they could flee the country. It was just vile, just wild what was going on there at that time, and just gypsies and. It was feral. The entire country was just...
It's like a post-apocalyptic world.
It really was. It was really... It was the most effective thing that's ever happened to me, being there and just witnessing that.
But you seem like you were more open to... Obviously, you had this experience traveling with modeling, but a lot of people wouldn't do that kind of immersive thing that it sounds like you've done every country you go, and you go, I'm here. I'm going to make it the most of it to try and absorb things that are here. Like, a lot of people would go to Romania to make a movie and just complain the whole time that the power's out every 2 hours. They wouldn't talk to the people or read poets or absorb the culture of the place that they are, which is a terrible shame, but I think is probably more the norm.
Yeah, and that was the hardest place I've ever been to do that, because everyone was just so
downtrodden.
They had the souls sucked out of them by his dictatorship.
Oh, yeah.
I have never seen anything like that. I have seen, I saw one time my friend got raped, and I walked into the house right after she got raped. And the look on her face, that was the look of every person in
Romania. The whole country.
It was literally like, I just got fucking raped.
Yeah.
And they did.
Yeah.
You see, like there was this massive castle, the size of 5 city blocks, and everyone else didn't have toilet paper and was killing each other.
It's like the Dark Ages. It's like medieval times again.
But Vivian and Linda wanted to make a beautiful movie, regardless of all of that. And I think that they did.
It definitely stands out. I mean, I was a huge, go to the video store all the time after I'd rented all, kind of like you did, all that, do the education piece. And then I start digging into, other obscure stuff. And then Full Moon was like, we're going to churn out 2 movies a month. So I'm like, all right, I'll get the Full Moon movie of the month. And it was always kind of like, yeah, that was that. But that movie, I remember putting on and being like, wait a minute. It's like a real movie now. This isn't just like, that was fun. And it really did stand out. And I think it was ahead of its time a bit in that. That could have easily have been like a CW television series 3 years later that would have been an enormous cult hit, like a Buffy style movie or, you know, television series or something like that. It was just sort of a few years ahead and kind of with the wrong company who was not, it was too atypical for that company, I think.
And it was good for me, although maybe misleading, because my experience with movies, what had been, as you know, like Nastasia Kinski and Olivia de Hussey, or Catherine Deneuve, or so I thought acting was sort of standing still and
it's very European sophisticate.
Very
inner turmoil.
Inner turmoil.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so I kinda did that. And I didn't really even know, I remember in Romania getting there and they were like, no, you have to learn your lines before you get here. I thought we sort of did it all together. We sort of ran lines and figured out what we were going to do on the day. And they're like, no, bitch.
Because that's what you would do with modeling, right? You kind of show them, here's your clothes.
Yeah,
and we're
just going to do it. Yeah, yeah. It's just kind of collaborative.
Yeah,
and they're like, no, it's collaborative slash you need to get your work done before you get here.
We only have so much film and we're doing one take, so you better have it right.
Exactly. I sort of felt like my inner turmoil was the more important thing than the actual dialogue. I didn't realize, but I was learning. So I learned fast.
Yeah.
But
on camera, which is not the ideal thing for people.
I was lucky though, because that's sort of what was called for. Like Vivi and Linda, unbeknownst to me, were actually doing a movie that was more along those lines. I was just watching, because as you know, there's the Blu-ray thing. I was watching a couple clips that were online the other day and I was like, oh, I was very good in that. And I think that, you know, it's funny because years later I was testing with Milos Forman for one of his movies. And he was like, so we worked together a lot. And at one point he was like, what's wrong with you? Have you done a lot of bad TV or something? And I hadn't done a lot of bad TV. But what had happened was that part of me that I had no experience with acting. I'd only had experience watching movies and watching those actresses act like that. And then I hadn't had any actual practical experience working like that other than Dark Angel.
Right. So you were trying to reverse engineer that
I think that without the opportunity to really exercise that type of acting, that sort of inner turmoil, being still story, I got active. And that's where... That is, I think, what he was talking about.
It was too big, he was kind of saying, that it was...
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, you probably overcompensated a little bit, too, because you were like, I'm doing this still acting. And they're like, no, you need to do this kind of acting.
There was a lot of that. There were a lot of auditions, and that even stayed with me for years later. There was a lot of auditions where people would be... I would come in, I would think, and I would work really hard.
Right.
I'd be very prepared, and I would come in, and I would do the scene, and they would say, that's good. What I think you need to do, though, is, and then they would literally verbatim describe everything that I'd done. Everything that I'd been
working on
for 3 days. And I started to get confused by that. And I think that I did what I did. and that they picked up on it.
Right.
And they saw it, but it was subtle.
Right.
And so they didn't.
They were like, they I like it, these things.
But they weren't comfortable. It had to be bigger.
Right.
It had to be more in their face.
Right.
And that wasn't where my strength was.
Right. And you don't strike me as that kind. You just seem as more of kind of a stillish kind of
I think
person.
That's where my strength is.
Yeah.
I can certainly flop all over the place.
Oh, yeah. I mean, like, I was going to say. Loud. Yeah. The comedy stuff that you've done is a lot bigger.
I flop all over the place on Friends.
Right. Friends or the Seinfeld or, you know, even in The Wedding Singer.
Girls.
I mean, obviously, that's an aspect of and something you can do and do very well, but it doesn't sound like it. It sounds like it's probably a little bit more work.
I think you're probably hitting on something. I think that when there's something that I like to bite into, I don't mind flopping all over the place because I feel like it comes from a place of strength. And not that I like to do it. I just think other people, it comes from a place of strength, even for an observer. It's because I'm being, you know, there's a little bit of meanness and control in comedy. So you're a little bit, so it's stronger to be like crazy and wild because you're actually telling a story that's about go fuck yourself. But with drama, I prefer to be still because I think the best stories are better told without flopping all over the place. Because it's really about communicating an emotion. And for the most part, you can do that without words.
Yeah, I think that because drama can go into melodrama when you do that. But comedy can't. If comedy gets too big, it just seems sillier. It doesn't seem like a.
The comedy, you have the writing.
Yes.
I mean, you
and
do.
It's pithy.
Because someone's going to say, you're supposed to be saying, oh, no, that's fine. I love donuts. But what you're really saying is, I fucked your brother.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, you can fit in undertones of the things there. Yeah. But, and in the drama, you'd be the person hearing, I fucked your brother.
Yeah.
And reacting to that, which would be a completely different thing. So do you ever watch anything that you've done? It sounds like you're not that into it.
I watch everything. I have to say there was a straight-to-video movie I did in the early 2000s that I sadly missed. I know there was some bugs. And again, I was in Romania.
Yeah.
And Christopher Atkins was in.
Okay.
But
had you seen Blue Lagoon?
No.
Okay.
But and he was lovely,
yeah,
by the way.
Yeah, I've
heard
he's
very nice.
It's
nothing against him at all. I missed that one. I think I've seen almost everything I've been in once. And I don't know that I really get anything out of it. There's always a bit of a cringe factor, but here's what I think I get out of it is I think I somehow intuit how much I need to improve.
Okay. So you watch it for sort of technical, almost like sports highlight films.
Well,
like,
I kind of watch it with my eyes closed, if that makes sense. I watch it and I often probably literally with my eyes closed, listening for my voice and seeing how was that true. I hear if that was truthful.
Right.
Oh, that must have been the day that I, you know, very distracted or not, or that was really grounded. And
so you look, you're sort of very technically examining it, but can you not ever get lost in a story if you're in it?
No.
Yeah.
I'm Aries.
Yeah. No, I don't.
I can't watch myself and get lost in a story.
I mean, that's, I can't do that either, which is one of the reasons why I never pursued acting.
I can't walk down the street and not get lost in a story without watching myself.
Yeah. Which is almost like a Twilight Zone twist for people who really like movies and really like stories, where if you're like, I got cast in this amazing thing or I'm doing this amazing thing, and you're like, oh, but now I can't watch it because I'm in it.
I would never be able to enjoy a movie that I was in.
Which is the ultimate sort of rub, because it's like the better the movie is, the more excited, or this is my favorite director, and you're like, but now I'm not going to enjoy this movie.
Yeah, but you get the thrill of working with someone that you love.
Right, right.
And that's you know, that's a hit. That's,
right.
That's
absolutely.
That's way more important to me than enjoying a movie. There's
right.
a billion
There's
movies
other movies
to watch.
You can watch. Yeah. So when I must imagine you started getting recognized a lot from like Friends and Seinfeld, especially, or The Wedding Singer were probably, you know, those are probably the most high profile things, and they're all comedic.
Yeah.
So were they like, Angela's a comedic actress? Were you getting like a lot of?
I was getting a lot of comedy things at that time.
Yeah.
Offers and stuff at that time. And I was auditioning for a lot of sitcoms and stuff like that at that time. But I was like, I liked the idea. I liked the hours of a sitcom.
Right.
That was attractive. Like an office job. Like making millions of dollars and yeah. buying a big house while you only work a couple of hours on Monday, a couple of hours on Tuesday, a couple right. of then Friday all night long. Like, yeah. that sounds fun.
Yeah. I have a weekend?
Yeah. yeah. Well, that sounded fun. And also, you know, the chance, you know, because sometimes the 1 hour, I'd done a 1 hour by that time and it was, you know, eight. It was really, really arduous.
Was that Cracker?
Yes, yeah. That was horrible.
Yeah.
And so you, that was just like, I was like, I don't want to do drama.
Yeah.
I don't mind drama, but in all, at that time I was like, I'll never do another homicide show ever yeah. as long as I live. And that's what I got all out of offers for after was homicide-y
right.
things.
And right.
I was
like, this procedural, never. Just grim, unrelenting.
It's just dark. Yeah. You know, getting up every morning at 4 o'clock in the morning to drive to Calabasas to look at dead hooker bodies.
Yeah.
That takes a toll on oh, yeah. you. And I'm not interested. And the kind of people who do that day in and day out, they get dark. And yeah. I just can't handle it.
And at least with a movie, you can let it go after you're done with the movie. But it's a series you're doing week in and week out. It's got to be
no,
just,
it's
yeah.
too much. And then with the comedy thing, I just think that, like, there wasn't really a thing that I was like, this is my thing. And so I actually developed a couple of comedies. I actually had a comedy yeah. for a while called Ginger that I sold to Dan McDermott over at DreamWorks when he was there and to Warren Littlefield at NBC. And that was a great show that I was... In the sense, that was a great show that I created.
yeah.
It was, what I mean by that was that character was a character that I could play day in and day out.
Right.
That's sort of been a thing for me. And I mean, I don't know who the fuck I think I am that I get to think that I get to pick that stuff.
Well, I was going
to
say, but it's you've created shows. That, that's unusual.
It's just that I know me and I yeah. don't want to be miserable. Being yeah. not miserable is more important to me than being rich or famous or...
Oh, yeah.
Or successful or anything. Like that's successful to me is
yeah.
being not miserable.
Yes. No, I 100%. I mean, I, you know, I still have a day job and all my friends who I started comedy with do comedy full time. But I'm like, I can't do that constant hustle. Like
that's,
when yeah. I don't have to worry about money, I can do stuff like this podcast or stuff that I enjoy without being like, oh, I guess I have to go do stand up at this guy's retirement party and make jokes about his wife because they asked me, you know, because I need the $200 or whatever. And I'm like, I can't do it.
No.
And it, you know, it's a give and take and it does mean, yeah, you do miss some stuff, but I guess it's, you
yeah.
know,
the I don't of, have yeah. a house in Malibu. But I'm not also a billionaire who's out of work and looking to get another chance.
Yeah.
But I can only do certain things because I'm so famous.
Right.
Like, no one else may want it, but I have the life I want.
Yeah. But that, well, I mean, that's really the only person who needs to have that life.
You know? Listen, I get yeah. with my brain. You got to be careful.
Yeah. Yeah.
You can't be like, you can sell your soul. Good luck. Have yeah. a great day. I don't have no judgment on that at all.
Yeah.
I'm not so lucky.
No,
it
same.
It gets real dark real fast.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely same. Like, oh, I can't. What was I? You know.
Yeah. No, it's yeah, too. Yeah. It's too. That's not my story. My yeah. story is be careful.
Yeah.
And so that was the thing is I did love Ginger and Ginger was a character that I could latch on to. For a while, we had a guy for a while who I love, Tom Brady, we still talk, who wrote a draft of it. That was good. And
yep.
he got it. It was difficult. It was a difficult character for a lot of people.
Because they have to get you.
Yeah. And they have that. The hardest thing was they have to get white trash.
Oh.
She was a white trash.
Yeah.
Martha Stewart. And you
yeah.
have to, I find a lot of people who are successful writers, you know, most of them, they come from like, you know, they went to Yale.
And, yeah. Or they're Harvard Lampoon guys.
Yeah,
yeah.
And bless them. But the honoring of white trash, coming from white trash from an under perspective and,
yeah.
and embracing all that is glorious about that and finding the heart in it without
yeah.
any judgment is very, very few people can do that.
Yeah. I mean, same, like I always on the show constantly complain about the loss of sort of blue collar television.
Mm-hmm.
And the last great blue collar show was really Roseanne.
Mm-hmm.
And that family,
yeah.
we didn't laugh at them.
The people that produced Roseanne loved Ginger.
Because it's a gallows humor that family has to get through life. And they had,
yeah.
you know, a lot of, it was constantly like, we're going to lose our house. We're going to lose this. But we weren't laughing at them. And television in the 90s switched, I think, from being... identifiable thing. Like I see my family and myself in that, to all either aspirational. Mm-hmm. I want to be on Dallas, mm-hmm. or let's laugh at things. Mm-hmm. So we got what I always call like poor face, where we get stuff like Married with Children, where I was like, look how poor they are. They're all sharing a lima bean, dumb poories, or, yeah. you know, like Honey Boo Boo, or we're laughing at these white trash people because we're like, who do they think they are? Let's watch them fail. And it's a totally different, I don't like that. And yeah, you want people who are, I mean, so many more people are kind of white trash than aren't, I think, in the United States. And part of the sort of American dream thing, where, not to get all political, but the, you know, the reason that a lot of blue collar, lower class people vote to cut their own throats, as they say, for things, because they feel like, I'm going to vote to cut taxes on rich people because someday I'll be rich. And it's sort of a toxic wow. mentality, instead of being like, I'm doing what's best for us, and we're kind of, it's always what's next and what's better. But there's a subtle thing where I think TV, when they show characters like that, they tend to either make those characters as schemers, so they're constantly like trying to look for an angle to make it big, or we laugh at them for being pathetic. And that's where I think a lot of people miss those kind of characters.
That's so interesting.
I mean, I love shows like that. We don't have them as much here. The UK has a good amount of shows. Have you ever seen a show called The Royal Family? Mm-mm. It was a show about this northern family, and every episode just takes place in their living room.
Oh, really?
They just sit around watching TV. Well,
I love all those Ricky Gervais shows.
Yes, yeah.
Oh my God, the extras saved yeah. my life.
Oh yeah, I mean, he gets a pompous character getting, that's the thing there. They'll laugh at someone who deserves it instead of somebody who, it's like a cheap laugh. Like, yeah. I look at a show like Two Broke Girls.
Because he's one of us. He's yeah. making fun of those assholes.
Yeah, exactly. You're deflating someone who thinks they're sort of higher off than they are. Not someone who's aspiring to do something.
Yeah, and exactly.
Yeah. So I could see how totally you would hit up against that, because it just, we don't have those anymore. And it's a show with sort of subtle struggles, where I think even a lot of the dramas now, it's almost too much. Like I get, even though everyone's like, all these great shows, which are very well made, they're just so unrelentingly like, all right, who's going to die next? And like, what other horrible, worst possible thing is going to happen to every character on this show?
I don't really watch that much. I like, I loved, and I'm going to forget the name now and I feel really stupid about it, but I'm such a fan of that character that I became a fan of the actor, House of Cards.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Michael?
Yeah.
Something? The guy, you know, the aide who killed the...
Yep.
The alcoholic relapse. Oh,
yeah.
Love him.
Yeah.
So much.
Yeah.
And I actually enjoyed the first couple seasons of House of Cards and enjoyed very much the Claire and Frank dynamic. And then... Not. And then Newsroom.
Yep.
Is that what it...
Yeah, Aaron Sorkin.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
I loved that show. I love him. I think I find him really interesting. Mostly what I think I love about him is that he does that thing that we were talking about earlier. He uses a medium as a guise for a very powerful and well thought out voice.
Yeah. He's an allegory guy. He's able to use these stories of which seem on the surface to be about just the struggles of these people or whatever they are, to say larger things about stuff.
I fucking love that shit.
Yeah,
that's That's my jam.
Yeah. You can get that. You can sneak it in that way.
That's what acting is, really. Acting is saying someone else's words using and telling your own story. Like in The Wedding Singer, that whole scene with Linda when she was there. That is not about that scene for me. That is about every fucking bitch in Winnipeg that was fucking mean to me with your fucking long hair and your tacky, nasty fucking life.
Yeah.
Marrying the guy from high school.
Move out of your town. Yeah.
Guess what? This is for you.
Yeah. I've immortalized you on film now and summed you up perfectly.
How do you like it? For me, it's for better or for worse. That's my life. That's my story.
Yeah.
And I love that. And of course I love, once again, David Hollander. And I worked on The Guardian with him years ago.
Yeah, yeah.
And I find, in my opinion, he does that a lot. The other thing is that he sees in people things that they don't see in themselves. And him casting me as a social worker way back when I was sort of floundering, trying to find post-Cracker, post-Friends, post-Seinfeld, right. post-what do you want to do with your life? And right. what now? I floundered, sort of, and by floundered, I mean, did a lot of drugs and yep. became homeless.
Hollywood flounder.
Yeah,
yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Like, it's a dainty thing.
Yeah, yeah.
And like, what are they, what's that euphemism they have for she did too much coke, where she's dehydrated.
Yes, yes.
She's dehydrated. Yes. Exhaustion.
Yes.
She's in the hospital for exhaustion.
Yes, yes. It's a sleep
because
issue.
She stayed up for yeah. 3 months on crystal meth.
Yeah. That would be exhausting.
Who is it?
Yes, it's true. If you worked, you should be in the hospital because you have some sort of weird physiology at that point.
Exactly. So casting me as a social worker, which later, you know, I ended up getting really, I had forgotten that I was in foster care.
Right,
I just
right.
sort of blacked that phase out of my as yeah. you do. And ended up getting involved with Children's Action Network and doing a lot of work with them and the Heart Gallery. And
yeah, you do a lot of stuff with PTSD and stuff like that. So, right?
Do a lot of work on myself with trauma work. And also, yes, I lecture about it now. And I have a beautiful boy who I've been a mentor of for almost 5 years now, who's got a lot of stuff and is amazing. He's going to be 17 in a couple of weeks. And it was one of those moments where being seen in that way, as being cast as a social worker, when pretty much no one in town would cast me at all, created in me this idea that I could be something more than yeah. what I was. It's almost like instead of, for most of my life, I lived... there was a life that I was supposed to be living and I was just going to keep working towards it.
Mm-hmm.
And then that was the moment when everything changed because there was something bigger in me that I hadn't seen yet that I was going to become
right.
that particular showrunner saw in me before I did.
Right. So not even just playing a social worker, you have the aspects of that person.
And didn't know.
Right. But it's almost like where you say, you know, I find that acting and I'm like, oh, this feels right. It's almost that kind of scenario, but on a you know, larger scale.
100%. And yeah. I was so attracted to acting out bitches and junkies. And I used to always say like bitches, junkies and whores. Because, you know, in Ill Town and The Wedding Singer, I mean, that was my strength. And I grew up with a lot of mental illness around me. So
same.
For me, playing yeah. that kind of person was like without
judgment. It's so more comfortable.
And
yeah.
a no-brainer. Yeah. Exactly. You observe it and you get it. And to transmute that. But the social worker thing, well, that was new. And that sort of... that planted some seeds.
Yeah. Yeah. Cause it makes you re-examine kind of the same, almost the same exact skill set and experiences to do the acting work you had done would lead you to that kind of work as yeah. well. It's an intuition. It's an emotionalness. It's being able to tap in and read things and translate them into something else, but just in a slightly different focus, which is pretty fascinating how those could be linked in any way.
That set the stage. One more thought.
No, yeah.
It's important because I want to honor, you know, Lena Dunham and Jenny Konner.
Yeah, yeah.
So that sort of set the stage for, well, who do I want to be? If I'm not just the girl who's getting along, acting out bitches, junkies, and whores, and there might be something more, then who do I want to be? And one of the things that I wanted was, I realized after a couple of bad experiences and year, you know, by now years in Hollywood, I wanted to work with people that I liked. I wanted to be inspired. And because for me, I'd rather work at a coffee shop than be around a bunch of miserable
Same.
People with
yeah.
saying shitty fucking words.
Yeah.
It's not,
yeah.
I'm not hitting. It's not,
just
that's
like,
not me.
Yeah. Very,
it's like,
yeah.
It's like we were talking about before. I'm too easily influenced energy wise
yeah.
to be like looking at dead hookers and saying shitty lines. When Lena and Jenny came to me and offered me a little spot on that show that I loved,
right.
admired, and felt it was also saying something really
yeah.
important. And really, I've been wildly affected by Lena's spiritual manifesto,
yeah.
what she's done and
yeah.
what she stands for. And so to be a part of that was really important to me. And then again, to play that girl on the episode 8 of season 4 of Ray Donovan.
Yeah, yeah.
And have, not just to get to work with someone as beautiful as John and Dash was amazing as well, But to play someone who's sweet and damaged, maybe, but in a different way, not right. in a, you know, more
things got
subtle.
More gray. Like uh-huh. you were able to present the people allowed you to present more of the layers of a person
yeah.
instead of just like, you're a crazy bitch. Exactly. But it's like, well, is she like that all the time? Why is she like that? Maybe she's not like that in this situation is sort of the next evolution of that kind of character, which I think as viewers, we are more open to seeing now too, because of shows like Girls and a lot of the sort of quality TV stuff. And in
she's
that
crazy,
respect,
but she's nuanced.
Right, right, right. But why is she like, you know, it's not so superficially, you know, crazy or like for yeah. a plot reason. And yeah. that is a good, you know, as much as I complain about how stuff now tends to be a little too grim or, you know, we don't have these strong blue collar characters and stuff. You know, there are some good things about the way that people are presented on television. And that being one of them, especially where characters who we would normally see in a movie, which is 2 hours, we can now explore over 13 hours or 26 hours, and you can get more of who they are and the different aspects of them.
And I wonder, too, the people say that the whole spiritual thing that's happening in the universe right now is that there's a big divide between the enlightened and the not, and it becomes with every, since the age of Aquarius, with every day becomes more and more accentuated. And I wonder if that is what's being reflected in TV that you're talking about, because that's according to everything you've said today, that would possibly stand true.
Yeah, because as you look, we get there's much less little middle ground shows. Yeah. You get your American Idol, and then you get your Mad Men. Mm-hmm. And you don't quite have a show that is like, you know, Roseanne or
All
in the Family, or, you know, part of it is because people watch stuff differently now. People don't watch things together. So they make stuff for very specific audiences.
Oh,
and it's not appointment tell. You know, your kid can watch whatever they want on their phone in the closet whenever they want to watch it. So it's not kind of like, well, this has to appeal a little bit to everybody.
I've heard that Night of and Workaholics are both really good. Is that true?
I haven't seen either, but I've also heard that.
Yeah, yeah. I hear
they're
that
on
that
my pile of
yeah
should
I hear
watch
those
these.
Are the jam.
Yeah, yeah. So there's a lot of good stuff out there, but it's almost too much good stuff. And the fact that we can watch
an embarrassment of riches.
Yes, anything we want whenever we want is, again, kind of a weird Twilight Zone spin. I want everything. Here you go. I don't know what to do with this.
I
stuff.
Like the Twilight Zone. I used to watch that when I was
that
when I was
changed
a
the generation. That show, I think, that taught so many of us so many good like
the one
moral
where
lessons.
The one where there's where you see a town and then you realize that it's a doll
yeah.
town
yes.
or whatever, a toy town yeah. that. Was the one that changed
yeah.
my life.
That everyone has that like Twilight Zone episode where you're like, oh my,
yeah.
what? I'm surreal, looking at
man.
Everything differently now
yeah.
from this thing that I just tuned in to be like, oh, TV show.
Yeah.
yeah. And that's what good TV should do, I think.
I think so too.
Cool. Thank you so much.
Thank you for having me.
Oh, you're welcome. Oh, baby, I see you. I told you she's great. Really love talking to her. Fascinating person. What a life story. I will put up links to all her social media stuff, information about her memoir. She's just great, as I said. You loved that episode, didn't you? You really liked it. I know that you did. You're nodding your head yes right now, and I can't see you, but I know that that's what's happening. Anyway, I am here every Wednesday, each and every Wednesday, with a brand new episode. Occasionally, I have episodes on other days of the week, so make sure you subscribe to the show, however you heard it, whatever platform you heard it on, iTunes, Stitcher, whatever it was, subscribe. And if you like the show, please rate and review it. Honestly, if you don't like it, you want to do 1 star, that's fine too, but I like the feedback. I love hearing from you guys, and thank you so much for listening. If you want to get in touch with me directly, you can email me at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com or at ken@icanread.com. iCanRead.com being my stand-up comedy page, as I am also a stand-up comedian. Or you can go to our Facebook page, just search TV Guidance Counselor, or tweet to us at TV Guidance, all over all the things. You can find us on all the things. That's literally all the things. Anyway, we'll see you again next time for a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor.
These people are crazy, just like me. What's wrong with you? Have you done a lot?